Hey folks, Sirdar here. In this episode of Dev with Sirdar, we're going to take a look at WebGPU, the next generation graphics API for web browsers, and a whole lot more. So what is WebGPU? Well, it's a recently proposed and implemented graphics API, mainly for browsers, but also available elsewhere, and it's intended to be a successor to the existing WebGL APIs. It's designed to make use of modern GPU features, and to work with those features by way of the newest generation of graphics subsystems on various operating systems, like Microsoft's Direct 3D12, Apple's Metal, and the cross-platform Vulkan standard. WebGPU is also designed to natively support things like GPU-based computation, also known as compute shaders, and to better unlock the performance of modern GPUs by using parallelism. The existing WebGL and OpenGL APIs don't make it easy to do those things, so WebGPU is a clean slate way to address all of that. Let's take a look here at WebGPU in action. What I'm going to show here is a JavaScript and web-based example, but implementations of WebGPU do exist for other languages and runtimes. But JavaScript is one of the easiest to show off, so we will use that. Now, the example that I have here creates a web page with a canvas element and draws in it a red triangle. Nothing spectacular, but we want to start with the basics to get an idea of how things work. The script block here contains the JavaScript code that we're going to use to work with WebGPU. Now, at first glance, this probably all looks very intimidating, but I'm going to keep things relatively high level. This first block of code here sets up our canvas object to work with WebGPU. This is basically boilerplate. It ensures that a GPU is available and that it can work with WebGPU as we need to, and it connects that to the canvas. Next, we create the shader programs that we use to do our actual rendering. Now, if you're not familiar with shaders, they're programs that get executed directly on the GPU, and we use them to perform the actual drawing operations. In WebGPU's case, they are written in a special mini language called WGSL, or WebGPU Shader Language. That gets translated into shader languages that are used on the actual platform that you're running on. So they work as a kind of an intermediary. Now, generally, when you write shaders, you have two shader programs that are used for most of the work. You have a vertex shader and a fragment shader. I'm not going to go into a huge amount of detail about how this works here, but the basic idea is that the vertex shader is used to describe the shapes of things, and the fragment shader is used to describe how those shapes are rendered into pixels at specific positions on the screen and with specific colors. So what we do is we write these shaders and then create what's called a pipeline from them. And a pipeline is basically a workflow. We feed in some data at one end, we have the shaders process this data, and our graphics come out the other end. So this block of code here describes how those shaders that we wrote are going to get used in the pipeline. They're used for what just amounts to a single step in this pipeline, but theoretically this pipeline could have any number of steps. And then finally we have the rendering pass. This is where we actually submit information to the pipeline and have it perform the rendering work, which we then display to the screen. Now, that's four stages and a few dozen lines of code just to put a triangle on the screen. WebGPU does have a lot of complexity to it, but the flip side is that many more things are possible overall with WebGPU than with WebGL or OpenGL. For instance, the pipeline, the workflow that I described earlier, has a lot more flexibility to it than WebGL does. We can add more and different kinds of workflows. And it's easier for us to integrate things like compute shaders, where we can perform math that isn't necessarily about drawing images. The other thing is that a lot of the complexity that you're seeing here is basically boilerplate. As WebGPU gains popularity and acceptance, most people are probably going to use higher level libraries like Babylon.js or 3.js. Those abstract away the fine-grained details. They let us concentrate on the actual problem. So here's an example of a WebGPU program that uses a higher level framework. In this case, I'm using 3.js, which currently has some support for WebGPU already in it. This is a pretty slick little demo. One of a couple of dozen like it on the 3.js site. And the source code for the whole thing, it's about 300 lines. And most of that is the web page itself, or things like the event handlers for the mouse movements, or high-level instructions on how to handle the virtual camera used to observe the scene. It isn't about assembling the shader pipeline or managing the rendering. That's all done automatically for you by the framework. So if you use WebGPU in this fashion, and chances are you will, you're not going to have to deal with the business of setting up the hardware or the canvas or even writing shaders. You can use the language you already know, in this case JavaScript, to do the work you want. But if you want to, you can lift the hood and delve deeper into it if you want to get ambitious. I should also point out that WebGPU is an API. It's a standard, and in theory, that standard can be implemented anywhere, not just in the browser. For instance, the Rust language has a crate or library that allows you to use the WebGPU API to create graphics, WGPU.RS. And there's even a Python library wrapper for it, so one could use Python as well to create WebGPU graphics. My point is that there's, in theory, any number of ways that you can use the WebGPU API. It's just that the in-browser version is the most convenient one right now, the one you're most likely to get your hands on with and work with. So to sum up, WebGPU is a new modern graphics API, chiefly for use in web environments, but which can, in theory, work anywhere the API is implemented. It's designed to take advantage of cutting-edge GPU features and make it easier to use the GPU for computation as well as graphics. However, it's complex to work with, so most of us will probably work with it by way of another framework that abstracts over it for the sake of actual work we're doing, whether that's graphics or computation or something else. And that's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below. And don't forget to follow Dev with Sirdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.